What's up guys, Nathan here. This video is part of a series where I explore the past league mechanics of Path of Exile. This includes explaining how they work, talking about their long-term effects on the game, and most importantly, making sure you know everything necessary to interact with and get the most out of their current iteration. For simpler mechanics, such as Anarchy or Onslaught, I'll be covering multiple leagues per video, but for more complicated ones, such as Delve or Betrayal, I'll be focusing on one league at a time. Today, we'll be taking a look at some of the simplest mechanics in the game, so I've decided to knock out four leagues in one go. These include Ambush, Invasion, Rampage, and Beyond. So without further ado, let's jump into the video. In March of 2014, GGG launched their first expansion, Sacrifice of the Vol. Along with crazy new mechanics such as Vol Orbs, Vol Gems, and almost the entirety of its series drop table, this expansion introduced 2 4-month leagues, one of them being Ambush. The premise of Ambush was fairly simple. You would find various strongboxes littered about Rayclast, click them to spawn some enemies, then kill said enemies to get the box to open. The exciting part is the contents of these boxes would vary greatly from completely useless to showering you with currency. This is because the strong boxes came in a variety of different base types, which I'll go into now. Regular strong box. Nothing special here, just your basic strong box containing assorted items, most of which are usually trash. Ornate strong box. Just like regular strong boxes, but with increased item rarity. Still pretty shitty, but still objectively better than its non-ornate variant. Large strong box. Basically an ornate strong box, but with increased quantity rather than rarity. Again, nothing really to write home about. Jeweler's strong box. As the name implies, this strong box contains jewelry. The value of this box heavily depends on the tier of content you're running. For example, opening one of these in Blood Aqueducts will rarely yield any items worth picking up, but opening one in an Elder Influence tier 16 map can easily lead to some expensive drops. Gem Cutter's strong box. Because most gems can easily be purchased from Lily Roth in Act 6 or the Epilogue, this strong box rarely drops anything valuable. However, it can drop the Gem Cutter Divination card, which isn't entirely useless. Blacksmith's strong box. Similarly to the Jeweler's strong box, this strong box's value is tied to the level of content you are doing, but instead of jewelry, it drops weapons. The main advantage of this is it can spit out 6 socketed and even 6 linked items, but I'll get to that later. Armorer's strong box. Basically identical to the blacksmith's strong box, but for armor. It's also worth noting this strong box can drop the body and the mayor divination cards, which are more than likely going to be worth more than anything else coming out of this strong box. Artisan's strong box. This one is almost exciting, as it's one of the first strong boxes you can slightly look forward to running into. It drops quality increasing currency, as well as the Master Artisan Divination card, and the Cartographer's Chisels it spits out can make this strong box surprisingly profitable. Arcanist's strong box. As far as common strong boxes go, this is definitely the most hype one you'll encounter. It drops currency, and if you roll it well and get a little lucky, you can easily get showered in Alks, Fusings, and Chaos Orbs. I'll get more into rolling soon, but just know this is a fantastic strong box in any situation. Diviner's strong box. Because divination cards have such a wide range of possible drops, this strong box can either be entirely worthless or really, really valuable. Do not open this strong box without crafting it, as that's just asking for disappointment. Cartographer's strong box. Much like the armorer's, blacksmith's, and jeweler's strong boxes, the value of this strong box depends on the level of content you're doing. That being said, running into one of these while doing level 83 content is one of the most exciting events that can happen, as you're more than likely about to receive a large number of red maps. Now that we've got the strongbox base types out of the way, we can get into a topic I've already mentioned a few times. Crafting your strongboxes. Like pretty much any other item, strongboxes can be modified to be normal, magic, rare, or unique. You can also increase their quality with Engineer's Orbs, which have the same 5, 2, and 1% amount gained, depending on rarity, just like any other item. I'm going to put up an image of a popular infographic used to teach people how to best craft their strong boxes. However, I'm going to add that because I'm a little lazy, I don't personally follow these tips in all situations. For example, I will very rarely bother identifying regular, ornate, and large strong boxes, let alone crafting them. This also goes for blacksmith, armorers, and jewelers as well, unless I'm in a high-tier elder or shaper map and feel the need to. I should add that volleying an armorer's strongbox is definitely something to consider if you have the increased strongbox quantity sextant active, as 6-linked items are a surprisingly common outcome from doing so. The last aspect of crafting strongboxes I'm going to mention are some of the more dangerous mods you can add. Some of these mods can freeze you, release caustic clouds, cast a large ice nova, ignite you, detonate nearby corpses, summon a stream of monsters, explode, and curse you. Since we still have 3 more league mechanics to get through today, I'm not going to go too in-depth on these, but I will be linking a fantastic Ziggy D video in the description below for those of you who want to learn more. But if you want some general advice, just remember that opening an unidentified strongbox should usually be accompanied by popping all of your defensive flasks and quickly running away. Running parallel to Ambush was Invasion, the hardcore league that accompanied the release of Sacrifice of the Vol. Compared to Ambush, Invasion was extremely simple. All areas read, monsters and bosses invade from elsewhere in Rayclast. By today's standards, this mod may not seem like much, but back in the day, these invasion bosses were terrifying. They had high amounts of health, damage, and fairly impactful mechanics that were not to be ignored. Plus, the general meta was much slower than it is today, so running into these enemies would commonly result in a relatively extended fight. Luckily, these invasion bosses don't pose nearly as much of a threat in modern Path of Exile, as many builds can simply kill them in seconds. That being said, if you run into one in a higher tier map before you've invested very much currency in your build, you might have a challenge on your hands. Here is a short list of the more dangerous invasion bosses to watch out for. Pewter Fang. This is one of the few invasion bosses I've actually died to multiple times. It's a huge spider that poisons you via Viper Strike, and due to its Shroud Walker passive and use of Flicker Strike, it will constantly be teleporting to your location. If you have low chaos and physical mitigation, you better be able to blow this boss up instantly or he'll relentlessly chase you down until you're dead. Shiver Shell. Although this invasion boss is seemingly weak and easy to deal with, it has one very dangerous ability. Its base type is a common shield crab from Act 1, so it has 2 phases, and when it reaches 35% life in its second stage, it will cast Vol Detonate Dead. Because this boss is usually found within a pack of lesser enemies and summons minions while it's alive, this can deal an extreme amount of damage to anyone who makes the mistake of standing in melee range when the cast goes off. Graveblood. Though not nearly as dangerous as its initial inception, this invasion boss can still do significant cold damage to unprepared players and their squishier party members. He will curse you with Frostbite to lower your max cold resistance, then spam Glacial Cascade and Ice Spear and use a cast when damage taken Ice Nova. To this day, some of the funniest Path of Exile clips on the internet are of old Vol Spark builds accidentally running into one of these guys, instantly proccing dozens of Ice Novas and killing their entire party. The next major content release for Path of Exile came on August 20th, 2014 in the form of the Forsaken Master expansion. This expansion would greatly shake things up with the introduction of master crafting, reworked boss fights, and of course 2 new leagues. The softcore choice this time around was Rampage. The concept for Rampage was probably one of the most simplest mechanics introduced to the game. All areas red. Slain enemies in a kill streak grants Rampage bonuses. In its most basic form, Rampage was simply an incentive system to kill as many enemies as possible as quickly as possible. To maintain this Rampage, all you had to do was kill one enemy every 5 seconds, and you would be rewarded with 1% increased movement speed and 2% increased damage for every 20 kills, as well as some specific rewards for hitting certain milestones. Here is a complete list of said rewards. At 15 kills, your Rampage officially starts, firing a Nova of Spears that damage and stun surrounding enemies. At 30 kills, you will trigger a single use of Detonate Dead in a large area around your character. At 45 kills, you will animate a small number of nearby weapons to fight for you. At 70 kills, you will trigger a single echoing nova that deals heavy damage to nearby enemies. At 100 kills, you will fire another nova of spears, just like you did at 15 kills. At 135 kills, you will animate a small number of nearby bows to fight for you. At 175 kills, you will trigger 5 echoing novas in a row, with about 1 second in between each one. At 220 kills, a cycloning weapon will spawn at your location, and if it kills an enemy, it will spawn another. At 270 kills, you trigger another echoing nova. At 325 kills, you will spawn another cyclone, and this time it will cause enemies it kills to explode. At 385 kills, you will trigger 5 novas of damaging and stunning spears. At 450 kills, you will spawn 2 enemy exploding cyclones. And lastly, at 520 kills, you will trigger large echoing novas that deal very high damage and explode all nearby corpses. After this last milestone, your rampage counter will continue ticking to 1000, but no more special events will occur. Today, Rampage still exists and is debatably one of the most fun mechanics in the game. However, similarly to Onslaught, its presence is now far more limited and can only be acquired by equipping specific pieces of gear. The most popular pieces of gear with Rampage include Shadows and Dust, Null and Void, Visco's Leash, and the Dancing Duo. If you've never played with Rampage before, I highly recommend casually trying out one of these items to experience it for yourself, as it really is a fun and unique mechanic. The hardcore sister league of Rampage was Beyond, and once again, this was a pretty simple league mechanic. Basically, killing enemies would have a chance to spawn a small red orb, and if 4 of these spawned near each other, they would open portals, summoning powerful demons from beyond. Furthermore, killing these enemies would have a chance to leave a bloody, gaping maw on the ground, and if 3 of those appeared close to each other, a powerful beyond boss would spawn. The key thing to realize about this mechanic is the unique bosses spawned by these portals were terrifying enough to put most invasion bosses to shame. Enemies like Haast, Unrelenting Frost, could off-screen you with GMP Ice Spears, and Tetztosh, Hungering Flame, could literally one-shot you with his Vol Flame Blasts. Of course, the rarest and most infamous Beyond boss is Abaxoth, the end of all that is. He uses a combination of all the other Beyond bosses' abilities, including a deadly gap-closing Flicker Strike, and has insanely high attack and cast speed. If you are playing hardcore, it's generally recommended to portal out of this encounter, as a high-level Abaxoth is probably one of, if not the most deadly enemy in the game. Today, Beyond is far less present in the game. It's usually available as a Zana map device mod, but otherwise, you can only really expect to encounter it as a Bloodline mod, a generic map mod, or in a Prophecy. That being said, when Beyond is available via the map device, it tends to be one of the most popular ways to juice up your endgame mapping experience, as well as provide your headhunter with tons of extra mods to steal. This works especially well in dense indoor maps, such as Underground Sea and Haunted Mansion, but that's a video for another day. Anyway, that about wraps up another episode of the history of Path of Exile Leagues. My next video is going to be about strong flashback starter builds, but make sure you tune in the week after that, where I'll be taking a look at Torment, Bloodline, Warbands, and Tempest. As always, this has been Nathan, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next week.
Thank you!
What's up, guys? Thanks for waiting to the end of the video. Sorry I'm whispering here because it's late at night and I don't want to wake up the GF. But I did want to thank my Patreon supporters, namely Real Human, Pete, Zikarak, Squally, Zul'jin, Coda, Julia, Alan, Keplerk, and new to the family, Fusk. Thank you guys so much for your support. It means a lot. I'm serious. Really, it's making up an actual portion of my income nowadays. And I also wanted to plug my Discord, which is right there in the bottom right-hand corner. I have that is open for Patreon supporters and non-Patreon supporters. I'm also on Instagram at NathanWalkerYT. My girlfriend keeps that updated with pictures of me, my cats, and my happenings. And you can also go check me out on Patreon at patreon.com/NathanBrotherBob if you're interested in joining these lovely supporter folks. Anyway, thank you guys for hanging out, and I will see you next week on Friday, probably.